anyway, we'll start with the first question here. And that is, this is a question you submitted. You said, in The Cell's Design, this book you wrote, I present a watchmaker argument for God's existence based on the features of biochemical systems. Do you think this is a valid argument? So do you want to set the stage for that question?
Yeah, sure thing. You know, a lot of people who try to make the case for intelligent design spend most of their effort essentially critiquing the evolutionary framework with the idea that if evolution can't explain the complexity of the cell, then it must be the work of an intelligent designer. And so in The Cell's Design, I try to take a different approach where instead of focusing on what I perceive to be challenging for the evolutionary paradigm, I wanted to make a positive case. What is it about the cell's features that I think positively point to the work of a creator? And I actually go back and I retrace some ground in history and kind of adapt William Paley's watchmaker argument to biochemical systems, making the point that many of the features of biochemical systems are similar to human designs and therefore reflect the work of a mind. This is, again, in the same vein as William Paley, who argued a watch requires a watchmaker, therefore biological systems require a divine watchmaker, where Paley was comparing the features of biological systems with the features of a watch. So it's a similar kind of approach to making a case for design, and again, where the goal is to make a positive case as opposed to critiquing an evolutionary framework.
Well, I guess I got a couple of comments. It's kind of maybe in reverse order, and I'll probably forget what they are, but one comment is that you said the designs, did you say the designs mimic human design?
Yeah, the designs in biochemical systems are mm-hmm. similar to human designs.
So in other words, like a motor or a rotor or something like that, and the biochemical
exactly.
rotor is like a rotor or a motor that we have?
Yeah, exactly.
I guess one interesting thing there, though, too, is I think that humans are also creating things that in many ways are actually better than biology, though, too, now. I mean, like when you think of supercomputers are amazing that don't exist in nature. And, you know, we create vision systems that are better than animals might have, for example, you know, seeing in the dark. And so, I mean, we can create things that are actually better than nature. What about that? How's that fit into it?
Yeah, well, I mean, let's take your example of a supercomputer system. You know, it's interesting. There's a new area in nanoscience and nanotechnology called DNA computing, or at least a relatively new area. And the idea behind DNA computing is traces back to Leonard Adleman, who is a scientist at the University of Southern California, who, for fun, was reading a book on molecular biology and noted that the enzymes that are manipulating DNA, let's say during the process of DNA replication, are literally functioning like Turing machines, where the DNA is essentially a string of information that the machine or the enzyme will operate on as the finite control, producing an output. And on that basis, he essentially devised the notion of DNA computing, where he and others are now building computers using DNA and, again, the enzymes that manipulate DNA. And one of the things that you can do with DNA computing is you can elicit massive parallel computations. And as a result, you actually have systems that can solve, with DNA computers, can solve problems that silicon-based systems can't solve. And so, you know, I would actually argue that these DNA computers are more powerful than our most powerful system. Now, the drawback is reading out the data while the computation is practically instantaneous. Reading out the data can take, you know, several days of work in a laboratory. But the point would be that, again, there's a similarity between a human design and a biochemical system.
Well, you know, since I work in the computer field, I know a little bit about computers. I don't know about the DNA computing. I've I'm just kind of surfacing knowledge about that. I heard about, I thought it was like in regards to storing memory or something, but I mean, just off the top of my head, it seems to me like the DNA code is very inefficient as far as, well, that's just for code, you know, for coding for codons, for example. I'm not sure how they're using that for processing, but you said you can process in parallel, but computers are, that's what the supercomputers are doing. Even the computer chips now, they have what they call multi-threaded. I have an advanced chip at home that has like, I think it's 12 or 16 CPUs in it. It's a high performance one because I got it from work. They gave us some free chips for working on the project, but that's small scale. I mean, even a phone, we got a quad core phone here. It's got four CPUs that could work in parallel. And that's just for a phone. But I mean, the supercomputers, they have, I don't know, maybe thousands of nodes working in parallel. I haven't read the articles, but I can't see how DNA would be a better processing thing. It seems to me the next big stage actually is quantum computing, and that's the astronomical benefit there, because then you can use the uncertainty states for supposedly all kinds of processing. Instead of just 0 1, you have the uncertainty state, which is supposed to be incredible, which is all brand new also, but we don't see that in nature anywhere. This is something where humans are going way beyond nature.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think you do have anything, to my knowledge, that's comparable to quantum computing in the biological realm, and clearly that would be a competitor to the idea of DNA computing. But where you get, I think, the massive parallelism that far outstrips supercomputer systems is essentially you're dealing with individual molecular systems. So, you know, even like in a gram of DNA, even though DNA is a very large molecule, you know, you've got an enormous number of molecules. Probably, you know, a mole would be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. So even if you've got, you know, a tenth of a mole or a hundredth of a mole, you basically have, you know, 10 to the 21, maybe 10 to the 20 operations happening in parallel in a test tube, and that's where you're getting the massive parallelism. And plus, because you're dealing with things at a molecular scale, these computers presumably operate at near 100% efficiency, or there's a very, very high, you know, efficiency with these systems, in that you don't have issues with heat dissipation and you know, have to be concerned with, you know, things like that. So that allows for greater efficiency. But, are these systems perfect? By no means. But, I mean, they are incredibly impressive systems.
Well, do you know anything about assembly programming, assembly code, machine code?
No, I don't really.
I mean, because machine code, this is the bottom line where the machine actually carries out instructions. And usually it's like load a value into a register. I can't remember now how to do adding and subtracting and stuff. But there's a lot of like loading and shifting, and I'm just trying to imagine, how would you get DNA to compute? How would you have like a loop on there, like an if then loop or something?
I'm a biochemist, not a computer scientist, so in a sense, I don't know that. But I have seen, I've got a couple of books on my shelf on DNA computing where people are actually working out those kind of problems. But I mean, the idea would be, again, that you've got these enzymes that are functioning like Turing machines, and so the principle would be similar, you know, to kind of Alan Turing's insight, where you can take these very simple operations and by stringing them together in different combinations develop rather complex operations. And in effect, you've got a lot of things that you can do with DNA and enzymes. There's a lot of different types of manipulations that are possible that allow you to essentially create, you know, these kind of complex tasks that you're referring to.
Well,
but the larger point would be, you know, the similarity between, again, a Turing machine, which was an abstract concept in Alan Turing's mind, and the fact that it's physically instantiated, you know, in the cell. So when DNA replication is happening, it really is a computer operation that's happening. Mm. That it fundamentally is similar to how Alan Turing conceived, computer operations, and the point would be that that is suggestive that the systems inside the cell come from a mind.
Well, some people say like the DNA code is like a computer code, for example, and I would take a lot of issues with that. I mean, on a very surfacey level, you can say that, but if people really took that seriously, I think there's a lot of misconceptions on that.
Yeah, well, I think I would agree with you when people throw that analogy around in a way that's not very thoughtful. But I think in this instance, at least with this application, with DNA computation, it really is code at least at some level. It literally is functioning as code.
Okay, well, our 10 minutes is up on that one already. So we'll move on to the next one. Do you want to? I guess you know we both didn't have enough to say there. So this is why we really have to focus in on what you know, try to maybe make one point and just talk about that.
Sure.
So here's the second question.